video's not playing.
It's not playing?
Yeah, you didn't click on the video. It's just playing the audio.
Okay.
Let's see. You click on the video, and then the video will pop up, and it'll take up the whole screen on StreamYard too.
Okay. Can I end it and just
start? No, go on, start it. I mean, this is the first launch. Sorry, Dr. Jacob. This is his first time working with this program. There's a little growing pain.
I prefer there. OBS, but let's. I mean, I could start this over again, you know.
No,
all right.
We'll do it live.
Do it live. Okay.
Still not working.
There you go. Everybody, I'd like to welcome you to the inaugural stream of the Killing Fields. And tonight, we have with us, joining us, Dr. Alexander Jacob, who is a expert and academic who's produced many profound and much profound research and many translations on National Socialism and a wide array of topics relating to that of European culture and European people. And joining us also is Cultured Thug, and we're going to have a very good conversation with Dr. Jacob. So I apologize for the little bit of trouble we had tonight, but this is growing pains. Look for us much, much more in the future. So go ahead. Why don't you lead us off, CT?
Yes, Dr. Jacob, thank you for joining us today and this morning in your time. Greatly appreciate this.
You're welcome.
You're definitely someone's mind I've wanted to pick for a while now. I've enjoyed your translations. I've enjoyed your works as far as Nobilitas and things like this. And kind of it's rare and rarer these days to find academics that are willing to delve into these topics and to do it like so forefrontedly, so out in the open and kind of a no compromise. I guess let's start this off as people, most people are going to know your history. Like, when did you make your decision as far as going into these topics and an understanding, like how it could hurt you fiscally, how it could hurt you socially, you know, throughout this modern society? And like, when you made that conscious decision to say, well, I'm going to focus on these no matter the penalty for it.
Well, I suppose it started when I was doing my master's in England. And that's when I really began to be interested in Indian philosophy away from India. And then I went back briefly after my studies in England to India, and I studied Sanskrit and Indian philosophy and everything. And then, you know, I knew that this was what I would be working within the framework within which I would be working for the rest of my academic career. So I went to America and I did my doctorate on a Cambridge Platonist, because they were Neoplatonists in the 17th century, the time of Descartes and so on, which is very unusual. And Neoplatonism is much like Indian philosophy. So that is how I consolidated my interest in Indian philosophy. And the Cambridge Platonists were also natural philosophers. And when I did my postdoctoral research at the University of Toronto in Canada, I continued to do research in natural philosophy, and then mostly German natural philosophy of the 19th century and so on. And that is the stream that leads directly, you know, to all the racialist views of National Socialism and so on. And all of them start to discuss the Jews and, you know, how very radically different they are from the Europeans. And so there's the philosophical basis of anti-Semitism itself there. And it is a position that I support. And as regards financial interest, you see, when I was young, I grew up in a fairly comfortable household. My father was a doctor, and I had everything I wanted. So I never really developed a desire to make money. And I suppose as a result, I have not made much money. But it was never a concern.
Okay, so, well, that's good, because it is for most people, unfortunately. Right. That's what keeps a lot of people away from these kinds of topics. Since we started off with bringing up kind of this Jewish spiritualism and the difference of it, not only, correct me if I'm wrong here, it's not only specifically with Europeans, it's with Gentiles overall, is it not, with the Jewish people?
What, you mean?
This friction, this kind of natural friction that's...
Well, they're only interested in making money. That is their main, you know, preoccupation, as it's written in the Bible or Talmud or wherever, you know, the aim is to acquire all the wealth of the world and dominate it. And since most of the wealth of the world is in Europe or in European hands, they have worked with them mostly, or against them, if you like. Mm-hmm. Not so much with the Africans or the Chinese. Maybe now they are somewhat concerned about the Chinese, but not so much. They've already built up their treasury, you know, over the years and centuries. So they're solidly based in Europe and America. So that is where the problem is.
Do you think it's with them in the history, do you think it's a material thing simply about money, or is there something spiritual there? Like, when you look at this thousand-year history of these conflicts and interactions and frictions between Jews and Gentiles, is it a material thing? Is it simply about the money with them in power? Or is it something deeper than that? In your opinion, with your studies and how you look at it today, like how would you try to explain that to someone?
No, there's nothing spiritual about it. It is the lack of spirit that is so alarming. They're just businessmen. They've always been, you know, traders and merchants and so on. And I've got increasingly successful at this business, and that's how, you know, they've influenced courts and monarchs and, you know, princes in Europe, and acquired their money, and finally ruined all the empires and got their own empire in Wall Street and Hollywood and everything. So that's all. Now, they have no spiritual inclination, but they have this great ambition to rule others which is also in their scriptures, and that is a great pity. So, you know, if they ever point to the Bible and say, you know, they're just being, you know, religious people or something, then you have to expose the lack of religion in Judaism. Mm-hmm. True religion.
Yeah. Yeah, it's very materialistic. Everything is with the here and now, the rewards of the earth and everything with them. Yes, it's very peculiar, let's say, as far as the spiritual religion goes. Do you think like America is like the pinnacle for them? Like this is the kind of perfect society for them, filled with consumers, people distracted with vice industry, pleasure seeking, things like this. Is this not... like Pat likes to say, a Masonic shopping mall, essentially, for...
It's very clear. And the problem is that everyone, you know, is still trying to emigrate to America, you know, all those poor Mexicans and Guatemalans and so on. In spite of everything they may or may not know, they're still trying to go to this promised land, which the Jews have created. So it seems like it's a model that has been rather successful internationally through their propaganda, their television, and their movies and this and that. Everyone still thinks, you know, that it's better on the other side of the border than in theirs. Yes. That is the problem with the people. People are so stupid as well.
Yes, yeah. Yes. Well, the propaganda, it reaches all over the world. Hollywood, entertainment industry, these things, yes, they still think there's a golden road paved to America and all their troubles will be taken care of once they get to America, unfortunately. And people are still following that dream. And living in the Southwest, I witnessed a lot of it, the illegal immigration and all of that. And let me tell you, it's not their perfect life. You know, a lot of these people are working back-breaking jobs under the table for little money, and it's not quite the paradise people are thinking America is. I wanted to touch on real fast before Pat comes in with some questions, just to wrap it up on essentially the Jewish question. We were talking before we went on air about spiritual Jews, essentially people who are Jewish in character and essence, but are Gentile, holy Gentile. Is this... I'd heard you speaking before, and I agreed with this concept. And even Otto Weininger. I don't know if you're familiar with Otto Weininger, the Jewish philosopher.
A little, yeah.
Yeah, so he had Sex and Character. He delved into Jewishness, too, and he ended up killing himself like at the age of 21 or 22, something like that. And he kind of dove into the characteristics of a Jew that can... You don't need to biologically be a Jew to have these characteristics. And this is what I refer to as like the spiritual Jews of the modern age. Do you think this is like a part of the reality of Americans, in particular, let's say Americans, because I look at this as kind of the tip of the sword for, you know, international Jewry and capitalism and all of this. Like, this is the tip of the sword here for that. Do you think like this is a real thing? Is this something people have to kind of be self-aware and make a valid effort at changing themselves and de-Judifying themselves? Or like, how do you view the concept of these spiritual Jews or Jews and characteristics?
Yeah, I actually object to this categorization as spiritual Jews, because they're not spiritual, but material Jews. It's the lack of spirituality that one is trying to overcome, to, you know, change. So, intellectual, if you like, Jews. Mm-hmm. They're intellectually Jewish. Right, that's because of, you know, the domination of education by the Jews, especially at the universities. And, of course, the media is another means of propagandizing their own worldview. So this is the essential problem of, you know, making Europeans, European Americans, European again. And this is a tremendous task. How are you going to do it? It's not going to come about through, you know, reading literature or, you know, watching new movies or anything. It's about changing the whole of society. And that can be done only through a new state, a state that does not include them, you know. So that's the sort of change that one must effect if one is going to change the mentality. The problem is, how do you do that in America, which began on very shaky foundations, puritanical and Masonic? You know, and those are both streams of thought that infused with Judaism. Puritanism is a kind of Protestantism that is full of the Old Testament, you know, and the glorification of the Israelites and this and that and the other. Everybody has a Jewish name among the Puritan society. And then there's Masonry, you know, that impelled the American Revolution. That is just secular Judaism. So you begin with this economic foundation that is only geared to making, you know, a living, making money, and so on. At least in the first few centuries, a couple of centuries, it was driven by some hard work, Puritan hard work, and, you know, the work ethic and this and that. But by the end of the 19th century, when all the Jews streamed in from Eastern Europe, then it turned into finance capitalism. And now you have Wall Street and all this manipulation of currencies internationally and manipulation at a very high level that nobody understands. You know, it's like working in another realm, like Elon Musk is working in the realm of Mars. These people are working in another financial realm by themselves. So it's all, you know, diabolical, and we have no defenses against it because we don't have the expertise in these fields.
Mm. So do you think the only way to pragmatically maybe change this course is if someone achieved power that wanted to make an effort at kind of changing the message of the country? Like you said, you can't just do it yourself, like reading literature. Someone needs to have power to take control of these propaganda vectors and then change the propaganda.
Right.
Like, is this the only way through, like, I don't know.
Well, that is the
only way. Political revolution or?
You have to start excluding them from government. The problem is you have Trump, whose son-in-law is Jewish and his daughter has become Jewish, or Biden, all of his sons-in-law or daughters-in-law or whatever are Jewish also, and so on. You have these families that are mixed. And this mixture with Judaism starts already in the 17th century in England, where the aristocracy worked in league with the bankers from Amsterdam who came back to England at the invitation of Cromwell. You know, they were banned from England for many centuries, from the 13th century until the 17th. And then once they came back with their money, then they have been working with the British aristocrats, actually. And they still do, I think. So, you know, this Anglo-Jewry is a phenomenon that is very, very disturbing. And they are operative not only in England, but also in America. In America, much more blatantly. So you need, you know, a government that is aware of this problem and wants to change it. It seems like no one wants to do that.
Yeah, well, no, yeah, they don't, unfortunately, or not the right people, at least, not yet.
If I may interject here, the question I have for you, Dr. Jacob, is what is it about Europeans that makes them susceptible to Semites, to Semitic influence? Do you think it's something intrinsic within them? And what possibly could Europeans do to combat this? You know, what is your opinion on why the Jews, kept coming, Semites kept coming in, you know, European society over and over again,
right?
And then repelled.
Right. Well, the history of Europe is a long history of anti-Semitism, as it happens. You know, it's first impelled by the Roman Catholic Church, which is anti-Semitic essentially. And then, you know, you've had many pogroms and this and that in Europe because the Jews were tax collectors and usurious, you know, imposing interest on poor people. And there were lots of revolutions, you know, popular revolutions against the Jews. And then came the big one in Germany, where, you know, the whole regime was anti-Semitic. That was, you know, the basis of the political philosophy of National Socialism. So that was the culmination. So it is not true that Europeans are philo-Semitic. They are whatever their government tells them to be. And so it's important that you have a government that is anti-Semitic. Only then can you have a change. Or at least not philo-Semitic, shall we say. because the term is now forbidden and everything.
Yes, who even knows what it means anymore? Just like all these terms, racist, Nazi, fascist, they've lost all their meaning. Now, any criticism of anything to do Jewish is anti-Semitism. So, do we need a... Because, like, to get rid of the philo-Semites, we would have to change the structure of our beliefs, like capitalism, business just for profit, this kind of mentality, vice industry, entertainment industry that people are obsessed with. Like, to make them stop being philo-Semites, we would have to remove, like, the strengths of the Jews, which people seem to enjoy, which is their mercantile kind of behavior. How do you think that starts? How do you think you even start changing that? Is this a sense of just riding the tiger, or can we become the tiger? Is my hope.
No, it's not enough to keep riding a tiger. I mean, it's not a very cheerful prospect. I think that you should be a little bolder in talking about the problem. The problem is no one talks about the Jews at all. There's alt-right and new right and this right and every right. They're just talking about, Heidegger and being and abstract ideas that are useless, absolutely useless in changing anybody, because nobody understands these concepts anyway. So, you have to talk about the problem and not be afraid of it. For example, in this case of Ghislaine Maxwell, the woman who is with Epstein, I think.
Yes.
They only talk about the trafficking of girls or whatever, but they never discuss the connections to Israel and the Mossad and so on that Epstein had, the whole family, even the Maxwell family, her father, and so on. So it's a large ring, but nobody is willing to discuss this because the media are all dominated by them also, so they edit everything. So you have to change that also.
Yes, they refer to her as an English socialite. I mean,
yes, absolutely. Yes. I mean, a very elegant lady.
Yes.
So, it requires changes, at every level, in every institution, such as happened during the Third Reich, which is one of the most philosophical regimes in the history of the world, because it was based on Weltanschauung, worldview, that is extraordinary. So something like that must develop again for a change to occur in society. It has to start from the top. It will not start from the bottom with people discussing things, forums and blogs and vlogs and this and that.
Yes. Yeah, it's an endless cycle. It's people, the most willing, most brave they'll get about it is, like you're saying, blogs, talking about it in spaces online, things like that. But there's very little real world action compared to what the National Socialists did, or even the Black Shirts of Italy, these groups that wanted to manifest their reality. It's there's very little of that today. And do you think that's a sign of the times? Is there too much comfort in the world? Like, what do you think is the difference between people from the 30s and 20s that were taken over by these philosophic political ideals? And willing to fight for it, willing to push for it, willing to dedicate themselves to it, as opposed to today, where you just like to see this endless cycle of, you said, like, this right, this right, this right, this blog. What do you think is the difference in mankind today, I guess?
Well, actually, you're right in pointing to a difference. There is a difference, actually. Comfort is the theme which propels Judaism, because they're always promising, increased welfare and happiness in America and that sort of thing. But in fact, the reality is the opposite. There are more and more poor people and fewer very, very, very rich people, right? The gap is widening. And you have Elon Musk and Bill Gates and Jeff Bezos, all Jews, with all the money. And then the rest are struggling. And in this struggle, they're so desperate, they will accept any crumbs that they get from the American table. It's more desperate than before, actually. And that is why you have this Bolshevism that is spreading around the world in the COVID crisis. The reaction to it is completely communistic, right? But everybody accepts it because they think it will lead to a better health and better future and this and that. Because they're so unthinking and they're so afraid. So it's more desperate now than it ever was in the 30s.
Yes, I agree. I mean, the Overton window, especially on degeneracy, has been moved so far, even since the 30s, to where we're at today. It blows my mind that things, they seem brazen to me. I don't know if you've noticed, but like if you look at media headlines from 20 years ago as opposed to today, they seem braggadocious and what they're doing and just kind of, you know, saying it right to your face these days with their headlines and everything else, especially with their efforts of sexualizing of children and things like this. It's surprising that more Americans aren't really getting pissed off, or more people throughout the West altogether aren't getting more angry about this. Do you think, like, the unfortunate truth is we're going to have to wait till we have a lot less comfort, until people are willing to dedicate themselves and sacrifice themselves, their time and their energy towards something that can change this government? Or do we have the potential to do that before we head towards, you know, Mad Max scenarios and things like this?
Right. I'm not sure militias and so on will help very much. First of all, they are infiltrated also. And then they're isolated also in the Appalachians or something, you know, and they're not going to bring about any revolution because the FBI is all over the place and so on. So, you know, it's not at those levels that you can make a change, unless it's very consistent and pervasive, you know, in every state or something, which I don't think is going to happen very quickly. So, you know, first of all, there must be clarity of discussion, even in all these little blogs and so on. People should simply discuss the problem as it is, analyze the problem for what it is, and you know, detect the source of the problem. No one is doing that, or very few people, apart from you probably, with your videos, which are quite useful, is willing to discuss the basic problem. This is the basic problem. It was 100 years ago. It is today, probably more so today than it was before.
Well, if I may interject here, Dr. Jacob and CT, do you think the problem arises is when many people kind of speak of Jews in a conspiratorial manner instead of, you know, seeing them kind of as flesh and blood sort of menaces? Because many people kind of inflate Jews to this like godly, superhuman status. And do you think that's a detriment when dealing with them? Because I think that can be quite an impediment.
Well, I mean, there is a Jewish conspiracy. Everyone says conspiracy theory, conspiracy theorists, and they dismiss it immediately. But it is a conspiracy. It is a Jewish conspiracy, actually. Whether they like the term or not, it is a fact, because they are well organized through Masonry and God knows what else, Israel. And so, you know, one has to talk about it. And otherwise, there's no, you know, way out. Apart from that, you know, people at the universities have to start distinguishing between, you know, a proper curriculum and a Jewish one. All of the books that you read, you know, by Jewish authors and everything. And, you know, people should discount all of this. I know, because I did my doctorate at Penn State in America, and I used to notice the behavior of many of my friends who were Jewish, actually. In fact, at the highest levels, you'll find only Jews in the best classes, like you know, the classics and philosophy and so on. It's all Jews, professors, and most of the students also, and they are dictating, you know, the discourse and the direction of it. Literature also. I remember in my literature tutorials, we used to have you know, discussions of books and so on, and then suddenly this Jewish participant will say, "Oh, this is like this movie from Hollywood," and it'll turn the conversation to Hollywood, because that is their empire, you know, and they want that to prevail over real literature, certainly old English literature, you know. So it's all part of an agenda. It's part of a conspiracy, and they are very successful at it. So we have to at least, you know, describe it for what it is. You know. It is a conspiracy. And it is a Jewish conspiracy. I know that they're all part of it, whether they are Yeah, political or not political, they're all in this Hebrew world which they are creating and want to prevail. So it exists and it must be discussed.
Would you agree that it's group evolutionary strategy at the end of the day?
Nobody evolves. Evolution stopped a long time ago. It's group survival. Yeah, you could say
Okay.
that. Because they're afraid of what happened in the Reich. Okay, but now that is 80 years ago or something. They cannot pretend that they're still afraid. Now they all know they are powerful, and we also know. And we have to make it clear that we don't like them so much.
But Dr. Jacob, wouldn't you say that kind of the greed and the avarice of like the Gentiles have been a very predominant factor in why Jews have sort of dominated Western society? Because from my research and from studying sort of European history, I've discovered that much of the, unfortunately, much of the aristocracy and much of the royalty seems to have used the Jews as a means to levy taxes on peasants, and the Jews have taken advantage of this as being a niche sort of group, and they've utilized the strategy to survive over the years. What do you say in that response? Because they seem to be doing the same in America, only with gender, race, and other various different social issues and social crisis that they seem to take advantage of.
Well, I mean, it was a survival strategy in the late 19th century and early 20th century. But with the victory of Bolshevism, they've had nothing but victories, except for this episode in Germany around that time when they lost considerably. But ever since then, they've regained their confidence and now their mastery. It's financial mastery. If you can, subvert them financially, that's fine. I don't know how you do it because I'm not a financier or anything. But otherwise, it has to be politically engineered, and that can only happen at the highest levels of state. You need, presidents who know this also and are willing to act independently. Maybe Kennedy or something. I think you need a Catholic, first of all, to change your atmosphere, your political atmosphere somewhat. Because Protestantism itself is part of the problem. This Trump, everyone is clamoring for Trump, thinking that he's some white nationalist or something. He's none of the sort. He's just a businessman with a Jewish family and spreading Zionism. Oh, by the way, this whole problem is Zionism. It's a new phenomenon. No one talks about it, but they call it globalization, the globalists and the elitists. But they're all Zionists, and this is the problem. That's spreading. So you need not candidates like Trump and even Biden. Biden at least is a Catholic, but he's sort of very weak and probably not going to change very much. So you need someone who is clearer in his view. I suppose the old conservatives or something, Buchanan, I don't know. Somebody from that generation, not this alt-right business and young people just prancing around and changing their affiliations every 6 months or something.
Yeah, that's all too common. But I think one of the benefits of Trump, though, was that Americans are frustrated with this two-party system. They viewed, no matter what Trump was, they viewed him as like a real populist at the time. And I think that kind of opened the door for Americans to accept more cruder, rough around the edges type candidates and more populist themes than used to be acceptable in America pre-Trump. So I think, no matter how bad he was, that whole election kind of at least opened the door where you could see you could have maybe a true populist party or ideology start to gain steam and momentum in America. So
Well,
I do hope that's the silver lining in the cloud.
I don't know. We'll wait for that party to develop. So far, nothing has
So
developed.
far, nothing. Yes, I know. Yes, I know.
Populism is now being directed towards, the Africans that you have. Okay, they are not a very powerful minority. They are impoverished and so on, and they're being brutalized. How can you have a populist party that's directing all its interest to such people who are really not very important? They should be directing their, you know, efforts to the people in power, which they will never do. They're too afraid to do that. So it's not really populist. It's another instrument, another means of the so-called elites, you know, to distract the political scene.
Yeah. It's a work in progress, hopefully, in America, because, like you said, there's no other option outside of becoming the power. It's like you said, this can't be something that just magically happens from reading books and, oh, they give up all their wealth and control now to these people. It has to be through power. So hopefully America's coming closer and closer to a time. I know it's more now. Americans are more divided. Americans are more interested in politics on one side or another than I've ever seen in my life, which leads me to believe there is a good climate there for political revolutionary mentalities and thoughts. It's just, like you said, the people, the parties, they're just not quite there yet. It's very lacking in that.
Right. Your work actually is exceptional in this regard among, you know, all the people who are spreading information through alternative social media, because you're focusing on the right movements at the right time in history, that is fascism and National Socialism, because those are very, very important movements politically and philosophically as well. And it's important that they read, I said reading is not so useful, but at least that they grow up in this atmosphere accepting fascism as a legitimate, you know, political phenomenon, and probably one of the best after monarchy and aristocracy.
Yes. What's your experience been in speaking with other academics on the topic of the Jewish question? Is this something you've tried to float out to other people and to see their response? Or how do people usually respond to that topic of a conversation, if you have it with other people involved with academics that you might have run across throughout your life? What's been your experience with those conversations?
Well, I don't normally discuss this with other academics. Okay. Actually, I'm not working in universities now. I just teach elsewhere. But academics are fully under control of the Jews. So I remember when I gave a paper on Eugen Turing in the University of Toronto, one of the attendees was a professor, a German professor, and he seemed alarmed. The Germans are most sensitive on this subject and will not discuss it at all. You know, so they've been brainwashed or something, re-educated, that's the term they use, since the end of the war. So, you can't expect much open discussion at a university level. No, it will not happen there. It can happen on the political, probably, but it must first happen there, and only then, you know, can the universities be changed, as the Germans did during the National Socialist regime. You know, once they got power, they excluded Jews from every intellectual office, every social, artistic, and everything.
Yes, yes, and that's in. I figured that. I just wondered if you had any experience with like academics actually listening or you know, taking into consideration these things, because my experience has always been you're dismissed as anti-Semitic or crazy or conspiratorial right away without even a platform for a back and forth discussion on the topic of the history of it and everything else. That's at least been my experience. And I haven't been to university in many years, but when I was there, I was a bit young and hard-headed, and I kind of put my foot in my mouth numerous times writing papers on these topics. And I would get called in by the professors and lectured for like 30 minutes about how I'm throwing away my life, this stuff is crazy. And I never met a professor that was willing to have an open mind and actually engage in conversation on the topic. So I'm not too surprised your experience is the same. And it's career suicide for these people too, correct? If they even indulge in this.
Right, but they have to, you know, a long time has passed since the end of the war. I don't think people need to be afraid so much. of Auschwitz and things like that, because that is a long time ago in a time of war, and the world has changed, and now it's the rest of the world that is suffering. It's not the Jews. They're just amassing their wealth in every corner.
Well, if you turn on the TV, you would think it's mainly them still suffering. I mean, that's kind of
Oh, it's best not to turn on the TV
Yes, exactly.
then.
If I may interject here, I actually have a question, Dr. Jacob. As you know, you're a person who studies history and European tradition. Where do you think the rot and decay set in for Europeans that led them in the present direction? Because while I do agree that the JQ and the Jewish question is essential to understanding sort of the modern day chaos, I also think one should also look inward towards the Europeans and understand sort of how this kind of moral rot set in. So if you could please tell me this.
Well, as I mentioned in a recent interview on another channel, it's actually from the English Civil War that saw the execution of Charles I and the introduction of the Puritan Cromwell as dictator in England. And ever since then, England has been turned into a Protestant haven, and welcome the Jews, and that's where the admixture of Judaism into Christendom began. And then you have the British Empire spreading all around the world, and in America particularly. That I would say is the fatal mistake that occurred. It occurred through an English Civil War that had consequences all over Europe. That's when liberal democracy began with John Locke and the Enlightenment of England and Scotland and everything, going over to France and creating the French Revolution. And then Germany put up a reaction, and that is why Germany is so remarkable. That is why I think the Jews are still afraid of the Germans. I can tell you something which is quite remarkable. I had a very distinguished Jewish professor at the university where I did my doctorate at Penn State. And he used to be a specialist in Plato. I will not name him. He's quite well known internationally and everything. But I remember when we were reading Plato, and suddenly he will talk about the Germans, and he would say, "Oh, I still shudder when I go to Berlin," he said. And I thought it strange. I don't know whether he did that, for effect or sincerely. I think it was sincere. They have an innate fear of the Reich and the Germans. So you can say, that they are still in survival strategy mode. But now they're all over Germany. They'll come back in large numbers, and they're dominating the society and everything. So anyway, that I mentioned simply to indicate what is behind their activities, their modus operandi, probably. But all of that has changed considerably among the people. The people are no longer under an anti-Semitic government in Germany or anywhere. That means that they don't have much to fear. And my position is that if you want people to change, you have to get the governments to change. And you don't need the governments to go, into such an extreme direction as the National Socialists did. But you can still, maintain your European character, which has been lost. And this is the great tragedy ever since the English Civil War. And it's happening in England as well. I told you, because of this admixture of Jewry in English society. And England has one of the most aristocratic societies in the world, because it's a well-preserved Norman aristocracy from 1066 and all that. So the two have been going together, and one doesn't distinguish the Judaism in English aristocratic culture, and that is a great pity. People are so easily deceived in England, which is crucial to any change, you know, because that is where these two have mixed. As I said, for Europeans to change, the governments have to change. For governments to change, they have to somehow, you know, put Jews back in their place, but not frighten them so much that, you know, they consolidate their defenses and then, you know, become more and more Bolshevistic. That is what's happening now. Right.
Well, let me ask you a question about that in terms of like Bolshevism versus National Socialism. From what I've seen in Jews, it seems they also have a tendency to infiltrate many nationalistic and also even some extremist positions throughout the history of humanity. They seem to have played multiple different sides. And even so, even within the, you know, Bolshevism, and even as it played out in Russia, it appeared also that at least, you know, Stalin became kind of apparent that the Jews perhaps were setting him up and they also were playing games with him. So what do you think this tendency is to Jews to sort of submerge themselves into all extremist sort of views to subvert these views? Because right. That's what I've seen. They practice this crypsis. And you can see this over and over in sort of white nationalist and also with National Socialist groups in America with the case of Frank Collin and also with Dan Burroughs. Even Otto Weininger shows this tendency towards a sort of self-hating Jew that wants to integrate themselves into Gentile society but still can't overcome their Jewishness.
Right. No, it's impossible to overcome Jewishness. It's a very strong racial strain. It is actually the Hebrew race. They say Jews, and you know, it's somewhat vague because not all of them are professed Jews. They don't, go to the synagogue or anything, but they remain Hebrews with their characteristic, you know, interests in finance and control and everything. That will never change. That means even if they say they're nationalist or ultra-nationalist or whatever, this Zhirinovsky, I don't know if you know him, he's a Russian politician who in Russia who says he's a nationalist, but is very comical and does not change anything. They're there just for show and for distraction. They will always be internationalists because that is where their money is. They will never be nationalists. Because they know what nationalism does in Europe, and they don't want it. So you shouldn't believe any of them. There's this fellow, is it Milo or somebody in the alt right? Remember
Milo Yiannopoulos? Yes.
Yeah, he's a Jew, so clearly Jewish, but then again with this elegant English aristocratic manner, and so on, and calling himself a nationalist or alt-right or whatever it is. All of this is deception, and you should be able to detect it immediately. The people, you know, are taken in by all of this comedy, the show, and, are deceived. So, I wouldn't take any Jew into my group if I had a group, and I wouldn't believe anyone that I heard saying that he's nationalist. They will never be there.
Let me also say this, Dr. Jacob. You mentioned that you think the West should look more towards maybe choosing Catholicism over Protestantism. Well, my question to you is, you're familiar with Nietzsche and like his transvaluation of values, and from which Nietzsche kind of thought the seed of destruction was already sowed within Christianity. Also your research into, the Indo-European cosmogony. Would you say that maybe the shift away from Christianity may be the solution to the Europeans' problem concerning the Jews?
Well, why? I told you, the history of Christendom is strongly anti-Semitic one. Why do you want to change that? Why transvalue all of that? Nietzsche is very subversive, you know, and nihilistic as well. I wouldn't go to Nietzsche for a solution. You know, it's all ravings about Zarathustra. Zarathustra is what, a Persian prophet or something? Not prophet, a Persian sage, shall we say. And the reason why the Jews like Zarathustra is because the Jews liberated them from their Babylonian captivity or something. So Nietzsche is very philo-Semitic, and I wouldn't go to him for any answers at all. And this rejection of Christianity is again subversive. They're always going on about Pope Francis as being a diabolical agent and this and that. In fact, no, he's a Jesuit. The Jesuits are a fighting organization. They know what they're doing. All of this is against the European Union, against the Roman Catholic Church. So no, this is not the solution. The solution is to go back to Catholicism and to the old Europe of Christianity, which is essentially Roman Catholic. Prussia, of course, was Protestant, but it had its own military discipline, which is exceptional. That is the Germanic character, and that is what actually caused, you know, this anti-Semitic movement in the Third Reich. That is their virtue, but only they have it, not the English. The English is just a facade of Christianity that includes the Jews as well. So, no, not paganism or anything. And first of all, there is no clear pagan religion now, except in India. That is for us, it's not for the Europeans, because you'll never understand our gods or our concepts. For the Europeans, there's Christianity, and that's all.
Interesting.
Yes, I guess you would have to have the same process to reclaim Christianity as you would the government, right? Because so many of the people in power are now, you know, Judeo-Christian in front of everything else. Yeah,
right. The alt-right in particular keeps saying Judeo-Christian culture, Judeo-Christian civilization, all these populist leaders in Europe, in Belgium and France and so on, but Marine Le Pen and all these people are inadequate because they're all part of this, you know, new Judeo-Christian ethos. With the inclusion of the Jews, you'll get no change at all. You know, you might as well stay where you are. Mm-hmm. Keep wearing your masks or something.
Well, if I might just contest that a little bit, Dr. Jacob, concerning Catholicism, how would you explain then the fact that Freemasonry and also Vatican II came about under Catholicism and under various different popes? The Jews were able to utilize the popes, depending on their avarice and greed, as sort of to weaponize them against sort of the peasantry. How would you explain that, and how would you be able to alter such corruption, considering the fact that after Vatican II, Catholicism has sort of become a more universalistic and more ecumenical type of Christianity, which is very inclusive?
Right. First of all, Catholicism has always been universalist. Catholic means universal, actually. So it is a gospel that they want to spread around the world. And they did it very successfully, for instance, in South America. I worked for 2 years in Brazil and 2 years in Mexico also. And I see that all of their culture is essentially Roman Catholic. All of their beautiful palaces and churches and so on are Baroque creations from Spain and Portugal. That is a sign of their success. You don't see such architecture from the British Empire. You'll see a few buildings in a few places. But they were not spreading Protestantism so much as Roman Catholics did. Because Catholicism is a stronger religion, actually. Protestantism is sort of individualist and this and that. Catholicism has had immense success all around the world. The Jesuits have set up a lot of educational institutions of the highest quality. And it's good that you have a Jesuit pope at the moment. Vatican II, that is all the emergency of the Second World War. It can be reversed and should be reversed by popes, of course, who are enlightened. But that will take some time because, you know, the church cannot give the impression of being, you know, a militant political organization. It can only try to spread its messages much as possible in the circumstances that it finds itself in. You know, Catholicism is the real religion, is the real Christian religion, and it should support any government that, you know, takes action in the right direction. They should work together somehow. They should come together and work together in creating a new Europe and hopefully a new America. But America is not terribly religious one way or the other, I think. So, yes, Vatican II, it's, you know, like the Nuremberg trials, you know, you'd say, why did they hang all those people or something? If you're sympathetic to the national citizen, why was Rosenberg hanged? He wasn't an intellectual or something. He didn't conduct the Holocaust. But all of them were hanged and everything was accepted because that is the new law of Nuremberg. And so also Vatican II, it's just a corollary.
So let me just hop to a topic since you brought up the Holocaust. I was interested in Adolf Eichmann. I have not read his memoirs yet. In fact, I didn't even know you had a translation of them until the other night when I was going through your catalog. And so I plan on getting that in the very near future. But from your personal opinion, what did we learn from Adolf Eichmann in regards to the Holocaust, World War II, what took place? What validity do you put into the memoirs? And what do we learn from that? What did we learn from him?
You learn from them what happened. That is why I translated them, because I thought it was a sincere record of all the operations conducted then. He was in charge of the transportation, as you probably know. Of the Jews from different countries to Poland and the Eastern territories. So he just records what he did, what he supervised, and what he saw. He also visited Auschwitz a couple of occasions and saw all the horrors. He was partly Jewish, I think. Anyway, he says at the end of both of his memoirs that it was a horrible experience. And, he philosophizes at the end saying that, you know, everybody should take personal responsibility for what they did and work towards a more liberal world and so on. So he was repentant, but the Israelis did not believe him and they hanged him also.
Yes, everybody. Everyone gets hanged, yes.
Yeah, so, it depends on how you view all of this. I think up to the Nuremberg laws, which exclude the Jews from society, you know, in many different specific ways, there was nothing terribly criminal about it. It was just their personal decision to, you know, employ Germans rather than Jews in high offices. So there's nothing terribly wrong. What happened after that, you know, the concentration camps is a matter of a war, an emergency, and the course of the war in 1941 when Germany was not doing very well in Russia and the Americans were threatening and this and that. So then radical steps are taken.
Yes, well, yeah, obviously. So Eichmann was, at the end of the day, did this guilt come from after being caught, or was there any signs before he was caught that he kind of had this guilt or kind of this about face about, you know, or this change of opinion as far as like nationalist socialist policies as to now looking for more liberalism? Was there any signs before he was caught by Mossad or...
Right. As I mentioned, I think he was partly Jewish himself, looked also partly Jewish. And he was initially in charge of the
He spoke fluent Hebrew too, didn't he? Excuse me. Didn't
he specialized. Yeah. He specialized in Judaism and Jewish studies, and he had Jewish friends and so on with whom he worked in the original office that he worked in, and that is the office that was in charge of the emigration of Jews. Until 1941, as you probably know, the Reich allowed Jews to migrate as long as they left behind their property and this and that. So he was very eager to get as many Jews out as possible in Vienna, Prague, and Berlin. And that was what he was doing. And that is why I think he volunteered to work in that department in the SS. Because he wanted them out, because he probably suspected that things would get worse for them if they stayed. And so he was doing all of that in a hurry, and then came the declaration of 1941 that they could not be allowed to emigrate because it's a time of crisis and war. And once they're not allowed to migrate, then they're trapped in Europe. So he says that he felt, you know, completely disconsolate, depressed after that, and didn't feel like he could work for the Reich anymore, but just went through the motions until the end of the war.
Did he ever admit to being Jewish, or was there a family connection? Or there's so okay.
You cannot. As an SS officer, you have to prove that you are Aryan. That is the term they used, and have been for many generations. So probably there's no evidence of any Jewish connection in his family, though, you know, he must have an intuitive affiliation with them because of the blood. Whatever it is, no, he never admitted, and nobody asked him also. These conjectures are based on some research that's been done by a German woman in Germany recently, and based on my own suspicion also.
Okay. Let's move on to Alfred Rosenberg now. This is what I just listened to a speech of yours the other night, or a reading of an essay on Rosenberg, which is great. Everyone should check out Dr. Alexander Jacob's YouTube channel. He has a lot of interviews and speeches up on there. And obviously, go find his books and buy them. He has great books, especially during on the Jewish question. And my personal favorite was The Track of the Jew Through the Ages by Alfred Rosenberg, a book I never even knew existed until you translated it and put it out there. What about that book was one of the ones that you said, like, well, I have to keep this alive for the English-speaking world to at least know what the man said on this? What was it about that book in particular?
Well, because it's very well researched. He wrote it when he was very young, in his 20s or something. Mm. But he grew up in Estonia, and Tsarist Empire, just when it was turning Bolshevist. And so he saw what was happening, how there were Jews everywhere taking over, all the institutions and controlling everybody and everything. So he spoke with first-hand experience of what is happening in the Russian Empire. And then his study of the history of the Jews is very focused, and it shows, you know, how they have operated, through the centuries. And he actually says the diaspora was not caused just by the Roman destruction of the Temple of Jerusalem, or Jerusalem itself, but predated it, that, right from Phoenician times, they've been all around the Mediterranean trading. And Europe was just another step in their internationalist adventures. So, it's a very interesting book, and I thought I should give it as a brief review of the history of Jewish activities. The other book by Düring is somewhat different. It's not a historical book so much as a study of their psychology. And he's one of the first who focuses on the Jewish question as a racial one rather than religious. Of course, the two are connected, but he puts it down directly to the Hebrew race, and he says it's unchangeable. And, so he's very blunt about it. These two works I thought I should translate, and I did.
Yeah, I'm very glad you did. The Rosenberg book, it reminded me a lot of Werner Sombart's The History of Modern Capitalism and Jews, because it's very well documented. You see, he resourced a lot of the surviving documents from there. Names are named in all the, when he's referencing certain Jewish merchants and whatnot, the Rosenberg book, you have the names and everything there and the history behind it. So it was very informative to me, especially when someone can document history like that. And also with the sources, very much like Werner Sombart's book. It was, yeah, very valuable, at least to have someone lay out this case, because if we looked at it today, we would think this only exists in this vacuum. But then when we look back from 1,000 years ago and you see the same trends, you know, it's pretty interesting. It gets harder to ignore. And that's why I always appreciate books like that, especially the Rosenberg one, where he lays out the history detail by detail and literally, you know, the track of the Jew through the ages. And he kind of brings you along on that path. So you can kind of see the history and go along with him on there. So, yeah, it's a great book. People in the chat should definitely check that book out. Is it you can't find that on Amazon, though. There's only a few of your books you can find on Amazon.
It was removed, actually. You can get it from Ostara Publications in England. Ostara, Ostara Publications, and it's available there. And another American recently contacted me and said he would like to reprint it, but since Ostara have the rights, I think they will continue to publish it. Right, that is that. And Turing is still available on Amazon, I think. The Jewish Question, it's called. Right, so those are two. But I've written, you know, much else on the subject and done many other editions that are still available on Amazon, I think.
Well, let me ask you a question, Dr. Jacob, concerning Alfred Rosenberg, something that's always intrigued me about Rosenberg's thought, and also myth of the 20th century as well, is he seems to have somewhat of a Gnostic sort of influence in his writings. Can you confirm this, that maybe he perhaps had some Marcionite Gnostic influences in his writings and in his worldview?
I don't think he would have spent much time on ancient early Christianity. He was just interested in restoring the Germans, you know, as a powerful race that had to combat international Judaism. I don't think he was terribly Christian. The National Socialists were not particularly. They were only interested in restoring Germany as a nation. You know that it suffered greatly at the end of the First World War, and that was the political impulse to the growth of National Socialism, because of the Treaty of Versailles. They lost much territory and they had to pay so much in reparations and this and that. And the whole country was depressed. And then Hitler came and raised the country by canceling the debt and then talking about the Jews as a great race from the past, and then the Aryans, and you know, as opposed to the Jews. And it was all a sort of reaction to the First World War. So, you know, you can say that the First World War caused the Second World War. The problem is the Second World War has not caused a Third World War. Okay, I'm not calling for a Third World War, but there's been no reaction at all. There's been total silence and submission, you know, all over the world. Right?
Yeah. That was the big win for liberal democratic capitalism. Right. And yeah, they've been holding the power ever since. Like you'll notice in smaller countries, when they try to build something nationalistic or third position, immediately all the democracies team up against them, sanction them, you know, call them the biggest enemies. So you see, there is a fear of that kind of politic from them.
Right. That is because of this widespread infiltration of the Jews. I've been teaching for 2 years in Morocco and now in Turkey, and these are Muslim countries. but there are Jews here. And, you know, as soon as you talk about Arab unification and so on, they will also talk about democracy. These are, you know, their favorite themes. And the Muslims are silent, you know, because they're afraid of getting a bad reputation or something as terrorists. So it's because they're everywhere and they have not been excluded. This has to start. You have to exclude these people from, you know, important positions in academia and politics and so on. Only then you'll get a change in society. Otherwise, their point of view will dominate that democracy is the best and the only way of government and this and that. Mm-hmm. You know, that your own nationalism is you know, barbaric or whatever.
Yes. Well, it's surprising to hear even in places like Morocco that's going on, actually.
Well, Morocco is completely controlled. That king, you know, is an autocrat. He has been for a long time. And the people, you know, do not resist. You cannot resist because the police force is quite strong. And he's always had a Jewish advisor. And now they are openly, you know, operating at a diplomatic level with Israel, which is very, very unusual for an Arab country. It's one of the few Arab countries that, you know, opened diplomatic missions for Israelis in their country. And so, you know, the alliance is growing stronger. That is Morocco. Turkey has a more Islamic government, Erdogan, but the Americans don't like him and they want to put pressure on him. It's not doing very well economically. And so this is their weapon, economic sanctions against yes. anyone they don't like. You know, so someone with some, you know, very strong will has to appear.
Yes. And so what do you think on geopolitics, what do you think the position of China is, and will they become the next America essentially, or are the Chinese a completely different people to where they're not going to be subservient to a foreign people? What are your thoughts on that with China and its future?
They're certainly very different people. They're not you know, European at all, Indo-European. They look different. They are different. So I don't view them as similar or comparable. They have ambitions because they have now imitated the West. They're all modernized and everything, even while being communist. And they have international ambitions. They want to build some, you know, Silk Road or something, again, through Asia to Europe and everywhere. But I don't think they'll be very successful, first of all, because they are so different. And they have nothing new to offer. You know, at least Americans have some technology which they invented and propagated. They have Silicon Valley and this and that. And everyone likes all of their little gadgets and iPhones and video games and this and that. The Chinese are just imitating. So they can only get what the Americans have left behind, like some African colonies or something. You know, I don't like them at all, the Chinese. I like them less than the Americans, actually.
Oh, yeah, interesting.
I'm anti-American, but I'm more anti-Chinese than anti-American because the Americans are, you know, are largely European. They have some memory of Europe, even if the, you know, the society is not terribly European but Jewish. But at least they have some potential, you know, to develop something like Europe, even if it's an imitation. But it's the same people virtually. Whereas China now is completely different. Their imitation is just like, you know, a bazaar in imitation. Mm-hmm. It's not authentic and it's not admirable in any way. Yeah. So I don't see them as similar to the Americans. I don't know about Israel's position vis-a-vis China. They probably will operate with them as long as, you know, they get material benefits internationally and mm-hmm. so on. But ultimately, Zionism is a force in itself that, you know, is widespread around the world and well established through the banks and this and that. And so, you know, that is the major hindrance to the development of European civilization, not the Chinese. Mm-hmm. Because it's so alien.
That's why I'm wondering with their population, at least. I couldn't see them, because they're so alien, I couldn't see them subjected to having their schools filled with Jewish intellectuals, their television programs run by Jewish producers. Like, at that very least, whatever friendship they make with Israel, which they've had a relationship, I don't see them like the Americans, because I guess most people don't even know, you know, what a Jewish person is. They all seem white to them. To most average people, they would say Jews are white people. So they don't see the difference. At least it's noticeable, I guess, with the Chinese population. So I don't think they would ever subject themselves to what America and the West has, as far as allowing Jews to be at the, you know, forefront of the think tanks and everything.
I don't know if they have any think tanks. They have a Communist Party, and you know, they have ambitions. But I don't know. In India, there is a danger of Chinese aggrandizement, of expansion, if you like, because they're very close in the northern part to India, and they want to take Tibet and this and that. Or they have probably taken Tibet, but they want other parts of the Himalayan region. And so they're a danger to us physically. They have been for a long time. They've been our enemies for a long time.
Oh, yeah.
So we know them. But that is a regional conflict. I know that they are taking over ports and, you know, other big enterprises in the West, because the Greek port, Piraeus, for instance, was totally bankrupt or something, and then the Chinese bought it. So that is a strategic gain for them in the Mediterranean. All of this is dangerous, but I don't see them as an intellectual danger. Okay, your point is a good one, that you know, there are no Jews in Chinese think tanks. That is because they're not important intellectually. The problem is Jewish involvement in the intellectual fields among the Europeans, and that is a greater danger. So now no one, you know, knows the difference between Jewish thought and European thought. They think it's all the same. And
it's the same, yeah.
Yes. And they're all white. This white nationalism is another dangerous phenomenon, because, you know, Jews will say they're whites or something and become nationalists. And anyway, how can you have a nationalism based on the color of your skin? It has to be on the basis of a historical tradition in a nation.
Yes. Well, I think that's probably...
Sorry?
Yeah. No, I think that's probably why there's been so much dysfunction, disagreement in those scenes like that, in America at least, is, yeah, because it's kind of built on shaky foundations to begin with. We're in a stage of time where I think you're just having people trying to figure out what they can do against this system, because it seems so powerful and it seems it's too big to fail. And so you have a lot of people who just give up right away, because it looks like this cannot be changed. But unfortunately, I think that's all throughout history, though. People always viewed that until it changed, until something came or someone came about and changed things. I'm sure Weimar Germany was the same. You know, no one thought this radical new society was right around the corner when you looked at 1920s Germany. And lo and behold, through Will Manifest or whatever else, you have this new society formed. So I'm hoping America's back in that cyclical part of civilization. Speaking of that, are you a fan of Oswald Spengler at all? Have you read his works or...
Well, yes, I've referred to his writings, especially Prussian socialism.
Socialism, yeah.
This prediction of decline and doom and so on is dangerous. You know, it leads the population to think that we're going to die anyway or something. So might as well, you know, put up with it. Now, Europe is not dying. Because it's still Europe. You know, if you go to Europe, you will see that all around you have, you know, reminders of the past, and a very, very glorious past. It's not dying or anything. You just have to change the people who prevent you from, you know, being European, that's all. And forcing you to listen to jazz in every Starbucks cafe here, and, you know, import all sorts of Americanisms into Europe. So I don't think you know, this whole theory of cycles of civilization is certainly valid, because we have a theory of decline of ages, but those ages are, you know, tremendously long, like thousands and thousands of years, and it's not going to happen in a few years. Europe has declined. The world has declined after the Second World War, but we know why. It's not because of any foreordained, you know, Indian religious precept of Kali Yuga or something. It is because of the predominance of the Jews in Western society.
Yes. On that topic, I was watching an interview you did about mainly about Evola, and a bit of, you know, speaking of riding the tiger, was brought into that. What do you think of that mentality? I've always said, instead of riding the tiger, let's become the tiger, you know, instead of riding out the bad times and just kind of being this aristocratic soul that knows better, but is simply riding the tiger, that the world has only changed. Like you said, not even talking about Spenglerian cycles now, but the world has always been changed by, my personal belief, like great men come and they motivate and they entice people and get them to buy into their vision and to their idea. And they have this ability to speak to the wants and needs of the masses too. I believe like this is, and I think we've seen this play out in Germany is a good example. Italy are, you know, great examples. And then even a Lenin in Russia at the time. So that this concept of, do you agree with, because it sounds like you also agree with like the concept of riding the tiger isn't very admirable, or we shouldn't at least be satisfied with that?
No, I don't think it serves any purpose to, you know, continue the status quo and then hope for someone to come, a savior, and you know, change the world or something. That's fantastic. First of all, this discretion has to, you know, emerge in everybody at the lowest levels and the highest. That what we have is not an authentic culture, it's not an authentic civilization. It has been imposed on us by, you know, entertainers, businessmen, and now through modern technology at a very alarming, you know, rate and speed. So, first of all, we have to recognize all of these pleasures that we have as being fraudulent and, you know, made for the people who are making money off them and not for us. And then one has to be, you know, content with less than what one is used to. At least in America, I think people have been spoiled by capitalism. And, you know, they expect to get more and more material comfort. And, you know, once they decide to live more austere lives, then, you know, they are probably going to be satisfied with the real pleasures of the world, which are not those that are offered by technology or Hollywood entertainment. So they have to change their view of thinking. All this desire to go to America and make money, lots of money, has to stop, because that is fueling the problem.
Yes. Well, the just the consumerism, the materialism, the hedonism, this seems to be the mentality of the day. And I've had this belief, and it's irrational, I get it, but like there is this spiritual void in people, enough people to where they realize these products will not fill that hole in them. And then this is where maybe revolutionary politics or someone with an answer comes around and promotes that. What are your thoughts on that? Do you put any weight onto like there's this underlying like spiritual void in people that's waiting to be awakened by something or someone? Or is it simply as simple as get power, change the messaging, and then everything changes? Like, what would be your personal view on that?
I don't think all people are equally spiritual in the first place. It's not possible to make all of them spiritual, you know. So change at a lower level, you know, is very, very difficult. And it has to come always at the top. But you know, this crisis, for instance, the COVID crisis has imposed so many restrictions on people that they've gotten used to having less than they had before. Many have lost their jobs and this and that, the opportunity to travel and so on. So many, you know, opportunities. If they have been able to do that for a Bolshevist government or international government, they should be able to do that for a fascist one, which is concerned about their spiritual welfare rather than their material. They've already undergone, you know, a lot of torment these last 2 years or whatever it is. If they can do that, then now they have to start thinking about a life without plenty, you know, and accept governments that are not connected to all these sources of profit.
We're very far away from that, it seems now. It's in your life, and I guess I'll wrap with this, and then if Frida has any more questions, he can finish. But in your lifetime of this, you've been around for quite a while. You've been aware of kind of what's going on for quite a while. What is your view of the future of the West? Where are we headed in the next 10 years? What is your personal view? How the trends are going? What do you personally think? You know, not to make a prediction. I mean, none of us know what the future holds, you know, ultimately. But in your kind of personal opinion, how do you view it going? Is it continuing the same path, or do you see anything else that could change the course of the ship currently? Or, you know, what is your future beliefs as far as the West in particular?
I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, let alone, you know, in a few years. But the course of the West can only change if you, you know, remove the Jews from the positions of power that they occupy now. Because I've been in Europe for, you know, 15 years or something here. And I know what is happening. The landscape is still European. It's just that, you know, people are listening to American music or something instead of their own. So it's just removing the obstructions to their own development. And so the principle is the same if you want to change it. Or else it'll go the way it is going now, the way of technology, you know, to the worlds of fantasy, like colonizing Mars. And if you want to go there, as if you need to go there to die when you can die here. You know, it's all absurd. But then people buy anything that they are fed by the media and, you know, celebrities and billionaires and, and so on. So one has to stop believing them. I don't know why they do, but people just believe whatever they're told by these financiers and these pseudo-scientists like Fauci and all these people, you know. So, you know, they should see there's a pattern in all of this. The crisis is only, you know, promoting the financiers. There's a connection between these two things, and they should stop subscribing to either one or the other.
Have you found at least conversation on the Jewish question in particular? Do you think it's spread? Do you think more people are aware or speaking about this? In your experience throughout these years, is it now more widespread, like even this topic?
I don't know.
You don't know?
As I said, not all people are intellectual. It is an intellectual question, you know, a question of worldview. And most people are only interested in surviving economically. So they don't talk about the Jewish question in bars and so on. They should, I suppose. But
if I'm there, they will. I mean, that's about it, maybe.
First of all, it's a question of changing your interests. You know, if the common people are satisfied with all this meretricious entertainment that they are provided to keep them happy, then, you know, keep them happy, but then take away all political power from them. You know, you cannot have a democracy. You need an autocracy that conducts its own government independently of them. They can play their video games if they want, but they will not be allowed to vote.
Yeah, well, I wish there was some form of voting restriction like that in this country. I don't know what terms of service, a test, something. Yes, it's the most insane political system you can think of, where just every person drooling at a television set now has an equal say in who the steward of the country is going to be.
Well, actually, they don't. Your politics are arranged by the people who donate to the candidates, right? The candidates are chosen by the donors, and these are people with special interests. So it's not really a democracy. But in any case, you know, the whole mentality has to change. American society is very superficial. It's very difficult to make it deep. It can only happen at the top, only if you have, you know, intellectuals guiding the nation or something, because you've never had an aristocracy or anything like it. So you need people who think about these matters. And you know, as I said, the old conservatives, paleo-conservatives of America would be a possible, you know, source of political potential leaders and so on. But it has to go in a particular direction that knows what the problem is and, you know, turns the country away from it.
Yeah. I mean, I guess I agree to the point where I think with Christianity in particular, what we're speaking about earlier, that the only way to get this country deep would have to be through some form of Christianity, some revitalized Christianity, I think is the only kind of spiritual fabric that's, that you can tap into in this country alone.
Right. It's, the problem is you're Protestant, and one of the strongest sects that you have is the evangelical, the southern ones, and these are spreading also to Catholic countries in South America, unfortunately. So it's all very powerful and political, because these evangelical people are also Zionists. It's all, you know, in support of Israel, which is the source of the problem. So you have to discourage evangelical Christianity. You have to restore something like the Anglican Church or something, which is a high church, by the way. Even though it is Protestant, it's much like Catholicism. So it has to be the Anglican Church or Roman Catholicism itself. For that, you need to get all the Irish people together and, you know, restore Roman Catholicism or something in their parts of America. So, yeah, Christianity cannot be evangelical Christianity. So that is also problematic, because you're largely Protestant.
Yes. It's true. It is true. I guess I'll end on this, and I'll pass it over to Pat if he has any follow-up questions or last questions for you. First, I appreciate your time. Thank you so much for taking this interview. I've enjoyed this conversation. I've been looking forward to it. Like I said, for quite some while, I've wanted to speak with you. And hopefully we'll speak again in the future after this as well. Okay. I guess I'll completely come from left field and ask you, since you've been in Istanbul, what is your favorite food you're eating right now in Turkey? What do you like about the cuisine?
Oh, God. I mean, Turkish cuisine is quite developed, and it's spread through all the Balkan countries. When I was in Serbia, before I came to Turkey, I noticed a lot of, you know, Turkish kind of dishes already, and sweets also. So it's a very developed kind of cuisine, and it's quite interesting.
Do you eat the lamb? Do you eat lamb? Are you a vegetarian or?
No, I'm non-vegetarian.
Okay.
But they all have Turkish names, you know, like döner, shish kebabs, and lahmacun.
Lahmacun, Turkish pizza. That's, I love that. Yes.
Right.
That's,
yeah, they have all sorts of things. Yeah, it's quite good.
Yes, well, try not to put on the weight while you're there then, because I know the cuisine is really good.
Especially since the other person seems to have a pizzeria or something.
Yeah.
From the Turks.
Yes, my pizzeria is quite explosive too. You might want to visit it sometime.
Right.
Meet me at the Piazza Fontana.
Okay.
But to top it off though, Dr. Jacob, I want to thank you for spending your time with us, for having this conversation with us, and in the future, I hope to maybe have you on some time to talk more about historical topics, which can overlap with the JQ. But I've heard the JQ so many times that I'm sort of fatigued from talking about it. I understand it's a very pertinent issue in these circles, and a lot of people are obsessed with it, but I understand it's the quintessential topic even to but I get a little fatigued from talking about the JQ sort of 24/7, especially how obsessed I initially was with it and still am to a certain extent, but I've kind of moved on. But I actually have kind of a left field question. What is your interest, and this will be my last question, what is your interest in Jean-François Thiroux, the Belgian pan-Europeanist?
Right. Well, I translated some of his works, as you probably know, and I am in favor of pan-European nationalism, and his theories are very interesting, because he also supported the European Union. I think he had many interesting views on how to organize the different racial groups of Europe. He didn't want anybody to dominate. Of course, he was French, francophone, and he didn't want the Germans to dominate, or the Slavs, or anybody. He wanted all of them to work together as Europeans. I think that is a good point. The problem is Europe, Western Europe, still has the Rothschilds, and Russia still has its Jewish oligarchs and so on. So until they lose their influence, you won't get a real restoration of Europe.
Okay.
All too true. All too true. Where can everyone find your books? Where can they find your YouTube channel? Any social media? Anything you want to promote, Dr. Jacob, before we wrap this up?
Well, my books are available on Amazon. And my YouTube channel, I don't know. Do you want a link or something?
Yes,
I don't know what it's called, by the way. But I can give it to you at some time. Do you want it now?
Sure, we can throw it in the chat for the audience.
Yeah, go ahead, put it in the private chat.
Check it out.
Put it out there. Find it then. It'll take a couple of minutes.
Let me see. I might be able to find it.
Okay. Your channel, it says. Okay. It has a very long name, I suppose. Copy.
Yeah, it's just Alexander and Jacob.
Where do I put it now, man?
Do you see where it says private chat?
Private chat. This camera. I've lost the page that I need.
I will.
I just uploaded it. I just put it in a private chat.
Okay.
You have. Okay, that's fine.
Yes.
All right.
Okay, good.
Okay. So, all right, you have everything you want.
Yes. So, Austria Press 2, for the books you can't find on Amazon.
Sorry?
Austria Press?
O-S-T-A-R-A. Right, Austria Publications. Yeah.
So, I highly recommend everyone check out his works. I have four or five myself. He's translated Gottfried Fredder's work. He's translated Rosenberg. He's translated Adolf Eichmann. He's written on Richard Wagner. And then, of course, Düring's work on the Jewish question. There's a lot of great works in there for people to check out. Many good books. I appreciate you keeping them alive too. It's like I said, we can't just be readers, but I do like reading, and I do love when people keep books alive that they tried to erase from history. And I'm sure you noticed that too, how they're digitally wiping books these days, and it's harder and harder to get your hands on these types of books.
I don't know what to do, but the point is just to be able to recognize that what they're doing is not worthy, and it's not worth much attention. They're trying to force their worldview onto you through their media and everything. It's all fantasy, and little children even should be able to recognize that it's a waste of time.
Yes.
So okay. Any closing comments, guys? Any closing comments, CT, Dr.
Thank you, Dr. Jacob. Yeah, thank you for the conversation. Thank you for doing what you're doing. I've appreciated it. You've helped me grow and learn, and I always appreciate that when I can meet someone who I've honestly learned from and been introduced to new thoughts and education and moments of history. So I appreciate that. Thank you for doing what you're doing. And I hope you stay strong and keep doing it.
You're okay. Welcome. And I think you're doing good work as well.
Thank you. That means guys, a lot coming from someone like you. So thank you. Yes.
Okay guys. Thanks for tuning in to our introductory episode of The Killing Fields. We got plenty more in store. And we're not going anywhere. And we're going to be here for quite a while. And we want to thank Dr. Jacob for coming around to talk to us about various different topics. And in the future, stay tuned.
Cheers, everybody.
Bye.